we have a talk by Raoul Arias, who will tell us about modern Hamiltonians in QFT, QFT and Garography. Please, 45 minutes.
Okay, good morning, good evening, and good night for everybody. First of all, I want to thank the organizer because they react very quickly in this pandemic world and organize this nice meeting that we are all enjoying for sure. As Irina said, I will go into talk about modular Hamiltonians in quantum field theory, algebraic quantum field theory and holography. I will be based in these four works that I did with these friends and collaborators, but mainly the talk is going to be based on this last one that has more holographic stuff, and these three, I will use results of these three papers to do examples of modular Hamiltonians in quantum field theories. So this is the plan of the talk. First, I will give you my motivation to study modular Hamiltonians. After that, I will do an introduction of the Tomita Takesaki modular theory, because I will, most of this talk is going to be based on that, and I have to introduce some notation and the operators that are involved in this theory. After that, I will show you some, you can see the mouse, no? And if I do this, you can see all. I will show you some results in quantum field theory for two in the vacuum, for a vacuum state. This is because of two reasons. First, because this is a theory that is very formal, and we have more intuition and we are more familiarized with quantum field theory. And I will say in thing about the vacuum because what we are going to study after is the modular Hamiltonian in excited states, and it will depend on the vacuum result. So we have to know the results in the vacuum. And as I said, half of the talk is going to be about modular Hamiltonian for some particular excited states that we call holographic excited states. And we are going to study this modular Hamiltonian in the algebraic quantum field theory side, in the quantum field theory side, and also in the bulk. After that, just a summary and some conclusions. So, my motivation to study modular Hamiltonians. Well, I will show you in these two slides, this slide and the next one, that it's useful in many branches of physics, and in particular in this slide is the one interesting fact about the modular Hamiltonian that is useful in quantum field theory and quantum information. Knowing the modular Hamiltonian allows you to compute the relative entropy in quantum field theory, because the relative entropy that measures the distinguishability between quantum states or is a sort of distance between states in the Hilbert space of states can be defined in this way. It's easy. I mean, this expression is easy, but it's very complicated to study this in quantum field theory in general. There are some works in conformal field theory that I will mention later, but this is a complicated expression. And then it's better to write it as in this way. In this way, where in the left hand side, you have the relative entropy. Well, I forgot to mention there is there are many, in quantum information, you find many quantities that can measure the distinguishability between two quantum states. For example, the fidelity, the quantum relative range entropy, the trace distance, and many more. These dots is because there are many more. In fact, in the past December, Takayanagi claim that using another kind of distance, this called Bourdieu's distance, he can compute the entanglement wedge using computation just in quantum field theory. Well, just a mention. Well, this form that I'm highlighting here is a better way to write the entanglement entropy to the relative entropy to compute to be computed in quantum field theory. In the left-hand side, you have the relative entropy between a reference state, sigma, and another state, rho. And in the right-hand side, you have the difference of the entanglement entropy between the two states, and the difference of the expectation value of the modular Hamiltonian that will be denoted with this k, computed in the reference state sigma, are these two expressions. From this equation, you can obtain the first law of entanglement. That is an important result. An important result because it's a generalization of the first law of thermodynamics, in the sense that this also holds in systems that are out of equilibrium. And in fact, 2 days ago appeared a paper saying that with the relative entropy, you can also give an expression with this quantum information quantity for the third law of thermodynamics. So in this context, the modular Hamiltonian helps a lot to know the modular Hamiltonian to compute the relative entropy. Also, it's useful in condensed matter and statistical physics. In that community, the people call to the modular Hamiltonian entanglement Hamiltonian. And it was shown many years ago that in this paper by Lee and Haldane, that the entanglement spectrum of this operator can characterize and identify topological states of matter. And this is a good property because topological states of matter are not described by broken symmetries. So this is it's interesting to have something to characterize it. Moreover, there is a kind of debate in the last years because also it's claimed that the entanglement spectrum can detect quantum critical points. And there is a lot of work showing that indeed, when you have a quantum critical point, the entanglement spectrum has a gap. But there is some counterexamples. So the question is there. Also, for example, you can have a theory on the lattice, and usually, if you are a quantum field theory guy, you go to the continuum with this field, with this theory on the lattice, and you have a quantum field theory that comes from there. Starting in the entanglement spectrum, you can obtain, before to go to the continuum, you can obtain the operator content of the theory. These are works that were started on with this paper, but there are many of them in the last years. And lastly, of course, it's useful in gravity because, for example, using the relative entropy and using the modular Hamiltonian, in this paper, there was claimed a better definition of the Bekenstein bound, that is a universal bound on the entropy of a region. Also, for the first law of entanglement, you can obtain the Einstein equations. That this is remarkable because you are studying quantum information quantities, and you can derive the Einstein equations. And the modular Hamiltonian is very involved in this relative entropy equals good relative entropy of JLMS. I will comment some about this at the end. So this will be a painful slide, but all the talks have to have a painful slide. Here I will introduce the Tomita Takesaki theory, also called modular theory. And I will define the objects that we are going to study later on the talk. Here, A is a von Neumann algebra, that it's an algebra of bounded operators that lives on a Hilbert space H. When you have a cyclic and separating state, you can define on this algebra this equation. This equation defines the operator S, that is called Tomita operator, and this is unique. S is unique and also is antilinear. A is any element of the algebra A, is an operator that lives there. And the word cyclic and separating is nothing more than this object. cyclic means that A applied to omega is dense on the space, and separating that A, the equation A applied to omega equals to zero, can be satisfied if and only if A is zero. So these are just words, but it's important because the Tomita Takesaki theory speaks about cyclic and separating states. Now, S has a unique polar decomposition in terms of another two operators that are the ones that we need actually. J is called modular conjugation and is anti-unitary, and delta is the modular operator, can be written in these terms, and is self-adjoint and positive. Knowing delta allows you to, okay, if you can do this computation, allow you to compute what is called the modular Hamiltonian, this expression. Now, the Tomita Takesaki theorem says that these three relations that are here holds. Here, A prime is the commutant of the algebra A. What this means is the commutant is formed by all the operators that commutes with all the operators of A. So what this says is that J, using J, you can go from one algebra to the algebra of the commutant. And what these two equations say is that there exists a uniparametric group of automorphism, this word is complicated, that is generated by this object. And this is called the modular flow. And I will talk a lot about the modular flow. So just what you need is to have a Fermonian algebra, a cyclic and separating vector, and you can construct the rest of the theory. As an example, to give an example with the hands, you can define a finite dimensional example where A is just the algebra of linear operators, a prime is the commutant, and your Hilbert space is this simple space. So here you can construct a density matrix. You can compute, you can do the spectral decomposition of the density matrix. And if all these lambdas are zero, you can say that this density matrix that do computation with this density matrix is the same that speak out this state that is written here. After some work that is not hard, is in fact reviewed very nicely in two papers. One is by Stefan Hollands from the last year, and another is a review of Witten from 12 years ago. You can compute all the objects. You can compute the modular operator, you can compute the Tomita operator, and you can compute the modular conjugation. And in fact, here it can be seen, it's easy to see from here to here, that the modular operator can be written as this tensorial product. And so you can construct the modular flow and the modular Hamiltonian. Just to mention here is that this first term is what we usually compute in quantum field theory, that is not the complete modular Hamiltonian. Because the complete modular Hamiltonian has two terms. And we are used to compute this first term. It's called inner modular Hamiltonian, or some people can call this half modular Hamiltonian because it's like the half. Now I will give some examples of the modular Hamiltonian for the vacuum state. Something that is important to note here is that all this Tomita Takesaki construction depends on two things, the algebra and the state. This is very important, the algebra and the state. So here we will use the Rinder wedge, that is just the x1 greater than x0 is all this. You want the algebra of all the operators that live there, and the state that you're going to consider is the vacuum. Okay, there is a theorem from the 75 by Bisognano and Wichmann, donde they compute the modular conjugation that is nothing more than the CPT operator that in many dimensions is called CRT. And they compute also the modular operator that has this phase and is nothing more than the boost generator. The boost, the generate, the infinitesimal generator of the boost. And as I said, in quantum field theory, the people is used to talk about the half modular Hamiltonian, that is just this. Know that the full modular Hamiltonian will be integrated over all the real axis, and this is the half modular Hamiltonian, and this is because it's in this way. The important, there are many important things. First is, this is for any quantum field theory. This theorem is very general. It's for any quantum field theory, you have this expression where this is the stress energy tensor of your theory. And here is clear what the modular flow and what the conjugation operator does. The conjugation operator takes, as I said before, an element of in this algebra, an operator here, and doing J, the element phi J, you appear on the algebra of the commutant. And the modular flow, what means this complicated word that is an automorphism? See, means that if you do the modular flow with an operator here inside A, this is the causal development of this region, then you are going to end in some place, but inside A. And here there is a comment that is very important. Typically, this flow is non-local. Typically, this flows, you start here, and your operator is going to be spread about any place in A. But there are some cases, and this is the more typical case, where this flow is geometric, and you are, as this is the boost generator, what you are doing here is take your operator and moving along an hyperbole. Well, with this, here is the same. This is Rindler-Welsch. You can do a conformal map of all this region, and what you note, that this conformal map is a special conformal transformation, mass translation, and all this region here is mapped to the causal development of a sphere, that is this shadow region on this double cone. And in this case, also the modular Hamiltonian generates a modular flow that is this tau. By the way, this tau, this t that you use to do the modular evolution is called modular time. This should be the modular time here. This is the causal development. Doing just the conformal map, you can obtain this. It's true that it's not easy to show that this k is related with this modular operator of the Tomita-Takesaki theory. But in that paper, they managed to do some checks that indeed this is the case. Another example is take an interval on the x-axis, if this interval B. For example, for free fermions, you can write the modular Hamiltonian as a bilinear, as the theory is free, you can write the modular Hamiltonian as a bilinear in the fields. These are two Dirac fields. This is the kernel of the modular Hamiltonian. And for Gaussian theories, from this paper, it's noted that you can write this kernel as function of the correlators. And then what you have to do is to compute the correlators. Well, for free fermions in one interval, it was done in this paper, and later on in this paper, here they use the resolvent method. What you want to do, first of all, is compute the eigenfunction of an eigenvalues of C. That is what you need to do this decomputation. And here they use the resolvent method and solve a singular value Cauchy problem. And they guess these out eigenfunctions. Here, there is an S here that I missed. And they do a numerical check about these eigenfunctions. And they compute this. And in this paper, I will mention something before. We did another method that is more mathematical, let's say, more formal to compute the functions of C and of K. And what you end up is with this modular Hamiltonian that has another compared with this. Well, by the way, this is called, do these things local temperature, because you know this is Rindler space, and in Rindler you have the Unruh temperature that is by the way, this x, but this depends on the point that you are, so it's like a local temperature. And in this case, we found this local temperature. This is an energy density operator, and we managed to show in these two papers that this local temperature is the same for free scalars and fermions, and also for free scalars and fermions massive with mass. So the mass is not important for this local temperature. What is true is that if you have a mass, this is not the complete modular Hamiltonian, you have extra terms as that is in the next slide going to be. And another nice thing is that this term, this local temperature that I'm showing here is related to the relative entropy. It's very related to the relative entropy. Can be measured, let's say, if you know the relative entropy. And a more complicated example is for free fermions and chiral scalars, where you have more than one interval. And what we did is to map this problem, what we want, again, is to compute the eigenvalues. What you have to do in quantum field theory is compute the eigenvalues of C, the correlators, and with that, you are in business. So we map this to an equivalent problem in the complex brain, with some multiplicative boundary conditions imposed on the intervals. For the free fermions, what you obtain is two terms that now I'm going to mention. The first term is what we call the local term, and this term is what you can measure with relative entropy. And the second term is the analog to this expression. And the second term is an unlocal term because you see you are integrating this function between psi of x and psi of 1 over x, essentially. And what you can check, that this was checked in this nice paper in Cassini Huerta 2009, is that this expression generates a modular flow that is not local, but it's quasi local, because when you start to moving your operator in this red line, you also start to see something in this another red line. So it's non-local. It's non-geometric, but in this case it's quasi, because you have in both sides. And also we extend this to the chiral scalar. The chiral scalar has T Hamiltonian, and in fact this J is nothing more than the chiral derivative of phi, the scalar field. Again, always as you, when you have a Gaussian theory, you can relate the modular Hamiltonian to the correlators of the theory and the commutators. Doing the same project, we found the modular Hamiltonian kernel. You can write in this way with some eigenfunctions that are not the same as here, but are similar. Again, you can write the thing as a local piece plus an unlocal piece, where by local we are just, the name local is just because we can do this, we can obtain this studying the relative entropy. We didn't in this paper, we compute all from first principles. And you have the local term that is the same as in the fermionic case, as we claim that the local term is the same for fermions and scalars independently of the intervals. And you have a non-local piece that I didn't write here because it's not illuminating. But it's just to say that this modular flow generated here is completely non-local. You start in one side and then the operator is going to be spread over all the region. Good. And this is about the vacuum. Some examples to gain some intuition. and now I'm going to talk about excited states. I don't know if there is some question so far. Good. The time, okay. Excited states. When you want to compute the model of Hamiltonian in excited state, less is known, let's say. In particular, there are some works, but less is known. For example, in this paper, Nima compute the expectation values of the model of Hamiltonian in excited states in a CFT. In particular, he developed a new replica trick. And he computed the relative entropy and also the expectation values of the modular Hamiltonian, as I was mentioning before. 2 years after, it was computed for a ball-shaped region, like in Cassini-Huerta-Mayer's paper, but the region is not as a ball, is a bit deformed. In CFT, the excited state was constructed using a path integral on the negative Euclidean time and adding operators on the origin. And now these other two papers are going to be a bit more interesting for us. Because of course in these two papers, I mean, you compute something that I want to say. You can compute the modular Hamiltonian, but in quantum field theory, but you are not sure that this modular Hamiltonian is the same as the modular is related to the modular operator of the Tomita-Takasaki theory. Then you don't know if you are computing a modular flow that has sense. So in this paper by Hong and Nima, they use an algebraic quantum field theory setup using all this formalism of Tomita-Takasaki. They compute the modular operator and the modular flow for excited states of this type that are general because these are general, it's very general. And they were allowed to compute the modular operator in this context. I will mention this paper again later. And also I will mention this later because in this paper that appeared like 1 month before our paper, they compute for a particular class of excited state that is the same as I'm going to use in this talk. This for Rindler, that we are going to compute on Rindler and some shape the former Rindler spaces, they compute the modular Hamiltonian in a perturbative wave to any order in perturbation theory. And they got the result. And the excited states, they got the result. This is a very complicated object but they were allowed to compute these integrals in some cases. It's a nice paper. And these states where this computation was done are what we call the Lorentzian excited states, because these states, first, how we generate these states. These states are generating doing an Euclidean path integral in Euclidean time, a path integral in Euclidean time with some field insertions on the time. And it was shown in all these papers that this excited states has a very clear holographic dual that is in this square green box. In the left-hand side, it is the excited state. In the quantum field theory, you see that it's like an evolution operator applied to the vacuum. And this evolution operator is this object, where this O is any operator of the quantum field theory. It's any operator, but if you want to make contact with the holography, it has an operator with small conformal dimension, is a single trace or a double trace operator. The integration is over the negative Euclidean time. This is the source that you have to put to generate a state. And this is a path order that I will mention something more about this path order later. And on the right hand side, you have the same object, this same object, but written in holography as this wave function, where you have, in general, a bunch of fields here living on the bulk, the Euclidean action, and some particular boundary conditions that you have to use. And these states are were very well studied, and in fact, you can show that for in perturbation in the one over n in large n in the large n limit in the bulk theory, this is the bulk theory. These states are coherent. These states are coherent, and you can see that also this coherence is broken when you add one over n corrections. In fact, if you add one over n corrections, you can have here, for example, a quadratic term in a dagger. These are ladder operators, a quadratic term, and you start to have squeezed states, something that is not coherent. And these states were also studied 3 years ago, very much studied. People, Tom and collaborators, show that there is always associated a classical geometry for these states, for these quantum field theory states. You have always a classical geometry that captures the entanglement entropy using Ryuta-Kashanagi. In this paper, it was shown that with these states, you can describe any near ADS spacetime. So these are particular excited states of a quantum field theory, but they're interesting because they have a clear holographic dual and they have nice properties. And also you can show that you can generate one or two particle states from these excited states. So these are the states that we are going to analyze for which we are going to study the modular Hamiltonian. So I define the state, now I have to define the algebra, and the algebra will be the algebra of operators that are on the Rinder-Wedge, as before, because this is the easiest way, the easiest algebra to use. And the Rinder-Wedge is very well described also by thermofield dynamics. Because of the Rinder-Wedge, what you have? You have the algebra of the right part, and you have the algebra of the commutant on the left part, the negative x axis. And in TFD, what you have is two copies of the same theory, that one is the commutant of the other one. So this is a very known, very well known thing, that Rindler-Wedge and TFD are related. So all the states that I'm going to talk about are coming from TFD. Also from the TFD formalism, you can show that this excited state that we create with this evolution operator is cyclic and separating as you need. So you are on the Tomita-Takasaki business. This one is the identity state of TFD. And the evolution operator is, as I said, is a path integration over the negative Euclidean time. And this is the modular Hamiltonian of the vacuum. So this is known. But this computation is non-trivial because of this path order. It's very complicated to do. So you have the global state, and now you are going to compute the reduced density matrix tracing over the left degrees of freedom, let's say, and you see that this can be written in terms of just of this geometric quantity that is a path integral. And now the reduced density matrix is just this exponential, this path integration, but now it's over an S1 because you are going, you are doing two rotations instead of just the negative x-axis. Now, we are not allowed to do this path integration, this path order, but in a very special case, when the sources that we are using to define the excited state are zero, does not depend on tau, you can obtain the modular Hamiltonian for this excited state. as function of the vacuum state model Hamiltonian with this term. Now, something I would add is that maybe you can expect this, because when you do that, when you kill the tau dependence of lambda, it's like you are having the vacuum state of a new theory modified. When if it's like if you have the vacuum state of a theory that has this perturbation to the original Hamiltonian. So this is expected. This is not so interesting. And I believe that from these expressions, if you do perturbation theory, you can arrive to the paper of Onkar that I mentioned, that was from this year. Well, having this, we compute the modular evolution, and also we did the Cassini-Werbmeyer's map to a spherical and tiny surface, and also compute the modular flow, but I'm not going to talk about this here. But this can be done. Now, for this exercise, I will come back to the vacuum state of these DFD states to do a better example. In DFD, you can write something that is called thermal state condition that defines the vacuum state, essentially. But you can write it in this way. These phis are operators on the algebra. This is on the algebra of the right wedge. You are in the Rindle wedge, and this is on the commutant, tilde means that you are on the left wedge. And you can noticing that the modular conjugation does the same work than the tilde operation of TFD. The tilde operation of TFD take your operator on the right wedge and move you to the commutant. So that's the same job as G. And using this expression, for rho, you can compute the modular operator in terms of these evolution operators. And knowing this and knowing J, you can see that this Tomita equation for S is satisfied. And moreover, you can see that, in fact, this is Ringler on the vacuum, so you know the result. And the result is nothing than this. Is the result that you know for the modular Hamiltonian, where this K naught is the modular Hamiltonian of the vacuum that I present in the beginning of the talk. Well, it's non-trivial, but it can be shown that this thermal state condition for the vacuum state can be also written for the excited state, for this particular excited state that we are studying. And once you are available to compute the thermal state condition for the excited state, you can do again the same, and you can compute again the modular operator using U lambda and U tilde lambda. And also you can obtain K lambda. But when lambda does not depend on tau, using this operators that came from the Tomita Takesaki theory that we are computing, we can show that this relation holds. And this means that this K lambda that we are computing, that was this one, in this case, is the one that generates this modular flow. But in the general case, when lambda depends on tau, we can construct this, we can construct this, but we cannot show, we are not able to show that this relation holds in this quantum field theory context. And here is where enters the importance of holography, because these excited states, as I said, are dual to coherent states in the bulk. So what we are going to do is show that this equation holds for the modular Hamiltonian and the modular operator that we compute here, but in the bulk. In order to do that, what you can see is that this thermal state condition in the quantum field theory can be rephrased in the bulk theory in this way, where phi r and phi l are objects on the right Rindle wedge and left Rindle wedge using the evolution operator, you can see that apply an operator on the right side, on the right wedge, it's the same as apply an operator on the left side and go with this evolution and came back with the tilde operation. So this relation is non-trivial, but it can be shown that it holds. Remembering this, you can obtain again the Tomita operator and show that this relation holds in the bulk. For the vacuum in this case, you can do the same for the excited states, and in this case is crucial that these states are coherent in the bulk, because then you can expand in ladder operators and you can do this step here. So we did it, and in this way we have a closer expression for the modular operator with in terms of this density matrix that we compute. Well, this is just the expectation values of the density matrix, the matrix element. And just as a comment, we can see that you can obtain the same result for any other subsystem, not just Rindler, that is connected to this by an isometry of ADS. And this is very formal. Then we can do an example. If I'm not very bad with the time, we can do this example. This you can take Rindler ADS, where U is the radial coordinate. This is a non-compact coordinate, that this is a sphere, that this guy and all these coordinates is going to be inside the letter Y. So what you can see is that these excited states in the Larsen limit that are coherent, and you can write it in terms of a displacement operator. The displacement operator do this over the ladder operators. So with this, you can follow algebraic computations and obtain the modular Hamiltonian in the bulk in this Larsen limit in this way, where lambda is the Laplace transform. And also you can see that this is nothing more, you can redefine this An plus lambda n with another An, Bn, let's say, and this is B dagger n, and this is like a canonical transformation. With this modular Hamiltonian, you can compute, it's not very hard, the modular evolution for this canonically quantized fields. And the modular operation, the modular evolutions give you this equation where this F for these excited states are classical solution of the equation of motion of the bulk on the bulk. This is again the canonically quantized field. And something interesting is that we obtain in the bulk a result. Well, this gamma is the derivative of gamma mu that is here inside the F is a Killing vector. We re-obtain in the bulk and in this quantum field theory in the bulk setup some result that Lashkari, Liu, and Rajagopal compute 2 years ago, but in the context, as I said, of the algebraic quantum field theory. They did it also for coherent states and they obtained something like this. And in this case, these coherent states are in the bulk. They were studying for general algebras. But knowing that, we can use the BDHM prescription to say something about the CFT. This prescription is comparable. This is a prescription that maps operators on the CFT and operators on the gravity side. It was shown by Stanford, I guess, after this paper, that this is equivalent to the Gabser, Polyakov, Klebanov, Witten approach that matches partition function of the CFT and of the gravity dual. These two approaches are equivalent. And what it says is that an operator here in the CFT. It's just the limit of you going to the boundary of this expression. This is the field in the bulk that is dual to O, and this is the conformal dimension. And assuming that there is a duality between the modular flows of the bulk and the quantum field theory, you can easily apply the modular flow and see that the modular flow of the operator in the quantum field theory, in the conformal field theory, can be written in this way. Where here appears the fact that you are not on the vacuum state. And lastly, another comment. Here what you have is as an operatorial equation, JLMS claimed that the conformal field theory model Hamiltonian can be written in terms of the bulk model Hamiltonian and an area operator. What we did in this paper is to compute this expression, K lambda matter. We didn't include gravitons in all the expression because it's 1/n correction. It's in the Larsen limit, all the gravity sign. But well, they use this expression, and what we claim in this slide is that for any region we can compute this matrix element of K lambda for the gravitons, this plus and minus is because you have to, for this state, you have to impose boundary conditions for using lambda, and you also have to impose boundary conditions for the induced metric. But if you know, because the boundary conditions are something given by you, so you can compute this, and the matrix element of K lambda matter have this expression. Does not be confused. This K, big K, is the extrinsic curvature. Yes, it seems like the model Hamiltonian, but it's not. And the solution for the field, this is general. The solution for the field is always written as a function of the bulk to bulk propagator and bulk to boundary propagator. But in this case, these are not the common bulk-to-bulk and common bulk-to-boundary propagator. They have to satisfy that on these surfaces, chi plus, or when has one leg on sigma minus, has to be zero. And the same for chi minus has to be zero when one of the legs on sigma mass, and also for this bulk-to-boundary has to be zero when they apply to this part. These are like this is Euclidean IDS, no? It's a semisphere. So we have here natural candidates to compute these matrix elements for any region A, because the region A, is what is going to determine your boundary conditions. So the summary, very good. What we did here is I did basic notion of Tomita Takesaki modular theory. I didn't enter in detail because there is a whole mathematical structure. It's a whole mathematical structure. I show you examples in quantum field theory for the vacuum state, standard examples, and I think it's interesting to compute this in quantum field theory by its own. We consider a particular family of excited states, where for that state we identify the modular Hamiltonian and compute also the Tomita Takesaki objects we computed, and we gave these expressions to the general expressions that are difficult to compute in the general case where you don't have a Killing vector, for example. So this is complicated, but it can be done. So that's all. Thanks.
Thank you very much. Any questions, please?
Can I make a question?
Mm-hmm. Yes, sure.
Okay, can you comment something on the J operation? When you excited the states, generally one would expect that both J and delta change. Could you comment on the J aspect of this modification of the states?
No, well, yes, yes. In this case, in fact, I didn't say nothing, but the delta operation changed, but J is general. Does not matter if you are in the vacuum state or the excited state, J is this delta operation. So does not change anything.
Okay, thanks.
More questions, please? Maybe I will ask one more question. You know, if we have a supersymmetry, then Hamiltonian is a part of a supersymmetry algebra. Do you expect something similar to modular Hamiltonian?
Well, it's complicated to compute a modular Hamiltonian in a free field theory. Even if you have supersymmetry, you have many fields that are interacting. So it's not known, the modular Hamiltonian, even for the vacuum. I don't know if this something of this can be applied to a supersymmetric field theory.
Okay, thank you. More questions, please? I guess people are tired.
No, okay. No, Friday night.
Yes, in Moscow is really a night.
Yeah.
Already, yes. Are you speaking from Italy or from Argentina?
No, from Italy. I'm in Trieste now.
I see. Okay. More questions? If not, let thanks Raul for very interesting talk, very appropriated to our mathematical institute. I hope not only people from my group, but also some mathematician will take a look on your notes and on your talk. So thank you very much, Raul. Thank you.
Thank you.
Bye.